Good morning. We gather this morning wherever we are in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our scripture sentences this morning are taken from John chapter 10. This is often referred to as Good Shepherd Sunday because the gospel lesson is about Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Jesus said, "I am the Good Shepherd." And our response, "The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." Our opening hymn this morning, as we'll be joining the congregation a few years back, is, "To God Be the Glory." Would you bow with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We give you the glory, for you have done great things. You so love the world that you gave us your one and only Son to be the shepherd who would lay down his life for the sheep and to prove himself to be that shepherd spoken of in Psalm 23, the one we can commit our lives to, who leads us through the darkest of valleys, through the valley of death itself. And so we can say with David, we fear no evil. Your rod, your staff, they comfort us. We gather this day as those who are entrusting our souls to the great shepherd of the sheep, Jesus Christ, and trusting that he is truly, as we'll read in the gospel lesson, the gateway to fellowship with you. It's through his sacrificial death that we enter into the most holy place of intimate fellowship with you, and out of that communion with you, have intimacy and communion with one another. For we receive this gift in Christ's holy name. Amen. We do welcome you to our worship service this morning. I want to apologize for the problem we had with the live stream. Seems to be related to the time of day when we're doing it, because we never have this problem any other time. And so that's something we'll need to be working on. As we have our announcements this morning, of course, you probably heard about the upcoming change in the governor's guidance. And to update us about all of that and what it means for Salem Church is Salem's Council President, Elaine Daniels. I invite her to come and share with us at this time.
Good morning. So sorry that we're not live today, as usual. I think the gremlins are out today with our technology. As Pastor David was saying, we saw the announcement on Friday from Governor Holcomb, and we are planning, we're very excited to say that we're planning to open up church services, all three, the 8 o'clock, 10, and 11:30, on Sunday, May 10th, so that's next Sunday, which happens to be Mother's Day, too. A very blessed Mother's Day to get to gather together. But we did want to do it as suggested in a very controlled manner. And if you've received the echo this month, there was a section on page 4 that we outlined some of the protocol that we're going to follow for social distancing. First and foremost, the governor is recommending that anyone that has any underlying health conditions, or if you're age 65 and over, that you consider not coming to the services until we're further down in our stages or gates. We expect everyone to also use good judgment. If you're sick, if you're having any symptoms, if you have COVID-19, please don't come. We ask that you not come at all. We will have all of our pews marked for seating, so we'll have sections where you can sit in family sections if you've been sheltering in place. We also have social distance seats, and we ask that you kind of follow those guidelines so that we're following the recommendations of keeping far apart. We'll do as we always have of not shaking hands, hugging each other, like we're in the flu season during our greeting times. We'll also have our offering plates at our entryways, both in the front door as well on the side door. And if it's communion time, we'll have prepackaged communion for you to pick up and drop off your offering as you enter. We encourage you to wear your mask when you come to church, if you're comfortable doing so. And we'll have hand sanitizer available. As we have been throughout the time, I know a lot of work's been done to truly sanitize the church. We will do that between Sundays. We'll continue doing our sanitizing to make it safe as possible. But I have to say, especially with our technical gremlins happening today, I'm looking forward to seeing our familiar faces. It's been a bit lonely sitting here by ourselves as we've had our church services, and look forward to seeing you again when you feel comfortable coming back. Thanks so much, Pastor David.
Thank you, Elaine. I want to also mention that I will be continuing to do the Thursday Bible studies at 6:30, even as we have returned to having in-person worship services. The Sunday school classes have been canceled for the summer, as has the Wednesday program. And so I know many of the people who have been involved in both the adult Sunday school and the Wednesday program are in a position where they want to protect themselves, and it would be better for us to continue to do the live stream Bible studies at least through the summer for sure. So I'll continue to do that, and that will work in lieu of having an adult Sunday school class and a Wednesday Bible study. I certainly have enjoyed that, and I've had my own technical glitches on that. This is a great learning experience for all of us, to be sure. Just continue to pay attention to the announcements. You got your newsletter recently, and we do post these on the internet, both as just a page where you can read the regular bulletin announcements, or you can get them as a printable PDF file. Well, as we go to prayer this morning, some concerns to highlight. Do be praying for the family of Linda Bailey. This is my brother-in-law's mother, Sue's sister's husband. She passed away. She was nearly 80 years old last Sunday, and she had an underlying condition with her heart and died as a result of that. And they had private services for her this past week. So do be praying for, that's her son-in-law, Ray, her son, rather, my brother-in-law, Ray Brown, his family, his sister's families, and for all who are grieving, her husband, Bob, especially, let us be praying for. Also, the family of Denny Williams, a friend of Mary Schneider, who passed away on April the 30th. Let's please hold that family in our prayers. And we'll continue to pray for all the needs on our prayer list. Would you bow with me this morning as we pray? Holy God, you have considered the straying sheep, and you have sent us a shepherd for our souls. Your one and only Son, Jesus, who is the Christ. We rejoice in that he laid down his life for the sheep, and through him we've been given eternal life. We pray now for the world for which he died. We pray for world leaders, for those whose calling is to serve the greater good. Grant them wisdom, we pray. May they truly act as those who are stewards of great power and authority. And may they recognize the one to whom they are ultimately accountable. We pray, Lord, for peace in our world. And we ask that this worldwide crisis would serve to bring us together. Help us to see the humanity of all people who are made in your image. And as the Bible even says in Acts chapter 17, are your offspring. May people come to recognize your love for them. And may they, knowing how much you love them, treat other people with that same love. We persevere, O God, in praying for all the work being done to combat COVID-19. We pray for all researchers, for healthcare workers, first responders, law enforcement personnel. We pray for people in the food industry. Especially we think of those working in the meatpacking and meat processing plants around our country. And for all who are working to help get us through this crisis, keep them safe, O God. Renew them in their strength. Help them in their efforts. We do not stop praying for those who suffer and for all who are grieving. Comfort families, we pray, in their losses. We pray especially for the family of Linda Bailey, my brother-in-law's mother. May they know your peace at this time and the assurance of the hope we have in Christ. We also pray for the family of Denny Williams, this friend of Mary Schneider, and ask that you would grant them your grace, O God, your comforting presence. We rejoice in the warmer weather and the beauty of the world you've given us, for the opportunities we have in spite of this moment of social distancing to get out into the world and to enjoy its beautiful weather. Truly, when we look at the world blossoming around us, we see a world of abundance. But that reminds us that there are those, in spite of the fact that this is a world of abundance, who suffer lack in their lives. And we pray for them. We pray especially for those who have lost their jobs or the businesses they work so hard to build up because of the present crisis. We pray, Lord, that you would bring them a turnaround, and that like at the end of the story of Job, where he was experienced more than he had at the beginning, we pray for these who have lost so much that there would be an overflow of a return of what was lost. We give all these cares to you, O God. And right now we take a moment of silence to present whatever individual cares and concerns and praises and thanksgiving we have to share with you at this time. Well, God, we gather up all these prayers and we offer them to you, praying, O Lord, hear our prayer. And we join once more in praying together the prayer our Lord taught us to pray, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we've certainly been enjoying the special music that people have been sending us from the places where they're sheltering in place. I think that's been one of the unique blessings of this time, is to see people in a different setting sharing with us the message through song, as the Bible says that we're to sing to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Our song this morning is Go Light Your World by Chris Rice, and the person who will be sharing that with us is Salem Sanctuary Choir Director Andrea Williams.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire. Confused.
Once more, we have the opportunity to present our offerings to the Lord. And as we've been spending time in the book of Acts, we're reminded that Luke began his second book. His first book was Luke, the gospel about what Jesus did when he walked this earth. He began his second book of the two-volume set, the book of Acts, by saying, "In my former book, I wrote to you about all Jesus began to do and teach." And he was implying that Jesus hasn't stopped working in the world. He's continuing to do and to teach. And, of course, he's pointing to the fact that it's in and through the church that Jesus is continuing his presence and his ministry on earth. And as we give, and we have in our offering plates today once more, the offerings that people have mailed in and others have given by using the online ability to give at this church website, salemdarmstadt.org. As we give these offerings and we present them, we're presenting them for the work of Christ, his ongoing ministry in and through the church. And so as we give this morning, we give to the Lord. We thank you, Father, that Christ, the Good Shepherd, continues to watch over us as we walk through this life by means of the community that he's given us to walk with, the body of Christ, the church on the earth. And through the work of the church, he continues to lead us, to guide us, to teach us, to touch us with his love. It's for that work of the ongoing shepherding of Christ, of the souls entrusted to his care, that we present these gifts and dedicate them in his holy name. Amen. Prepare to hear God's word to us this morning. One of the ways Jesus continues to teach us through the proclamation of his word. And we'll be reading from the Acts passage that we left off with last week, and then the passage in John about Jesus, our good shepherd. But would you bow with me as we pray? Father, we thank you that you have not left us as orphans, but you have given us the presence of Christ through the Holy Spirit who is in us in this world. And we continue to receive the care and love of the good shepherd in our hearts and lives. Right now we turn to the Word to hear him speak to us, to hear you speak to us in this hour. And we ask you, O Lord, to speak, for your servants are listening. Again, our first reading is from the account of the early church in Acts. Last week it was of the first Christian sermon, and now we see the result of this sermon, which is the gathering of the Christian church. These 3,000 who believed last week are gathered in. And then we read a description of what that gathering looked like. Hear now the word of God as it's found in Acts chapter 2. Speaking of the 3,000 converts, it says, "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to everyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved." Here ends our first lesson. Today's second lesson is the gospel reading for this Sunday, why this is often called Good Shepherd Sunday. It's from John chapter 10, where Jesus says that he is the shepherd of the sheep. Hear now the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. I tell you the truth. The man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him, because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him, because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, I tell you the truth. I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Here ends the gospel lesson. These words are true, and they can be trusted. Thanks be to God. This time we'll have our children's message. Again, I'm so glad that we can have this time together, even though we're apart, and we can speak about the things that give us comfort and peace, because these are the things that can never be taken away from us. Even if we have to isolate from other people, they can always be with us, and that's a great gift. I brought with me something you might be familiar with. It's getting to be warmer weather. Yesterday we had temperatures in the 80s. You might have went outside, played in your yard, rode your bike, had a great time enjoying the weather. And soon we'll be going to places where we'll see these. Maybe we'll go to a public swimming pool or to a water park. Won't that be fun? I heard the governor say July 4th, they'll allow for unlimited going to the water parks and things like that. And the name for this device that we see at those places where people are playing in the water is called a life saver. That's what this was first called. Now, many of us are familiar with the candy called life saver. Well, that's where it got its name. This was called a life saver first. And because that candy is round and looks like a life saver, they gave it that name. But they use this lifesaver, of course, is not a candy. It's something that is actually used that if someone starts to find that they're not able to swim, maybe they're getting a cramp or something, maybe they just went out in too deep of a water, this can be thrown to them and they can be saved. Now, how are they saved, though? They're saved not by looking at it. They're saved by holding on to it, by trusting it. Did you hear that both of our scripture readings today use the word saved? First of all, in the book of Acts, it ended. The last sentence of the last verse said, and God added to their number daily those who were being saved. And then Jesus said, I'm the gate, and those who come in through that gate basically come into my fellowship, into being with me. That's what fellowship means, being with. Those who come and are with me, they are saved. That's a key, important Christian or church term. And what does it mean in that way to be saved? We know when you hold on to this, you're saved from drowning, which means physically dying. But you know, the Bible says that what sin does is that it kills us spiritually. The wages of sin, or the the result of our sin is death. But when we come into the gate, Jesus says, that's another way of saying, just like a person has to hold on to this to be saved, it's not enough just to know about Jesus and to hear that the story about him is true. It's to trust him for yourself. And that's why he was saying, all who come in through me, who are looking to me as the answer to their lives, who recognize the problem they're having, it's not drowning in water, but it's drowning in the wrong in their lives, the sin in their lives. If they'll look to me to the answer, meaning they'll come into the gate, they will be saved. And then he says right after that what that looks like. He says, I've come that they might have life, and that to the full. Think about what happens when you hold on to this. You have physical life. Your life is saved. In the same way, when we hold on to Jesus, we're given full life, which means spiritual life. The blessing of having God in our lives and being alive in ways that we wouldn't be otherwise. And the great gift that comes out of that is never-ending God kind of life, what the Bible calls eternal life. Let's thank God for the gift of being saved or salvation. Lord, we thank you that this is a beautiful world and we're going to get out and enjoy it. And more we're going to be able to be with groups and we'll be able to go swimming and go to water parks and do things. And thank you for the life savers that are there. We think about the guards, the lifeguards they're called, who are watching over the people swimming. Help us to recognize that Jesus is the ultimate lifeguard. That's what he was doing as a shepherd. He was watching over and protecting the sheep. And he's our lifeguard, watching over and protecting us. But he did something amazing. He said, I lay down my life for the sheep. And help us to see that when he did that, he made it possible for us to have never-ending full life with you. And may we receive that for ourselves by looking to him as our answer to sin, to the wrong that has kept us from you. For we receive that gift in his name. Amen. Well, this time we'll be joining the Salem congregation a few years back, singing about this great gift, the church, and its one foundation that we've been talking about, Christ, and that great hymn of the church, The Church's One Foundation. At this time, we have the opportunity to confess our faith. We'll be joining together in the words from the book of Romans that describe why it is that we can be saved or made right with God. Christians, what do we believe? We believe all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of His blood to be received by faith. At just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Our preaching text this morning is the last verse of the first reading from the book of Acts. It says there, "And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved." Would you bow with me as we pray? Oh, Father, we thank You for this hour of worship and for the fact that Jesus Christ is still doing and speaking to us this day. We ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in Your sight, O God, our Rock and Redeemer. For we pray it through Christ our Lord. Amen. In this town that we are located in, if you're watching from far away, we're located in the greater Evansville, Indiana area. There's a church not far from us that I drive by quite a bit that does a good job of putting up thought-provoking sayings on their church signs. Some people just have a gift, I think, of coming up with a saying for their church sign that gets you to really think about things. And I think that's a rare gift because more often than not, you see sometimes things that you think maybe shouldn't have been up on that sign. They are more off-putting than they are inviting and winsome. And the signs sometimes are not so much spiritual, but are more public service announcements. I think of two that I read recently. Honk if you love Jesus. Text while driving if you want to meet Him. It's a timely saying, not really much about a spiritual kind of thing, but telling people, you know, you really shouldn't be texting while you're driving. Another one that's very apropos and current is 6 feet apart today is better than 6 feet under tomorrow. Again, more of a public service announcement. And some of the signs are intentionally funny, and some are funny because they didn't mean it to sound the way it did, but if they would have thought about it, they would have seen that they maybe should have changed the wording, such as, "Don't let worries kill you. Let the church help." I don't think they were really thinking when they came up with that sign. And I really like this one. "Do you know what hell is? Come hear our preacher." Now, that one really struck me as funny. "Do you know what hell is? Come hear our preacher." But one that I think is especially apropos as far as the passage for today is one I saw years ago. It doesn't make much sense to younger people, but to older folks like myself, they'll understand what this is saying. It's an old one that's been used on many church signs. It says, "Kmart is not the only saving place." There was an ad that the store Kmart used to have, "Kmart is your saving place." And that was a jingle they used over and over again. And so churches picked up on that and said, "Kmart is not the only saving place." That really is apropos because both of the passages that we read from today, as I said to the children, have this term saved used in it. Jesus said, the one who comes in through the gate into me, basically, because he says, I am the gate. So the one who's trusting and looking to me, they will be saved. And then Luke says that of this group of people, the formation of the Christian church, that God was adding daily those who were being saved. I want to talk a little bit about this idea of being saved. It's a term we associate with certain groups of Christians nowadays. I don't think people often realize that some of the very first Christians to emphasize that term, I mean, it's always been in the Bible, but the emphasis that has been put on it in more recent times, which I say in the last several centuries, part of it goes back to this very church that we're a part of here at Salem and to German pietism. And our church's teaching document, our catechism that we use to teach our children, in the very opening questions, that word gets introduced. So that in question two, it says, how do we obtain this righteousness? Because the first question was, we need to seek after the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And so question two says, how do we obtain this righteousness? And the answer that kids are taught to memorize and to know, and if you grew up at this church and you studied the catechism, this was one of your questions. All those years back, all the different generations who've studied here, the answer is, we must believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we are saved, is the answer to question two. And then so question three says, what then must we do to be saved? And the answer is, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that accenting, you don't see that in the earlier Protestant catechisms, the accenting of the word saved, really started with German pietism. And a part of the emphasis there was as they were trying to say that Christianity just isn't about knowing about Jesus. It's not just about having intellectual knowledge about what he did and what he accomplished. It's about personally receiving it for yourself. And even today when people ask, have you been saved, they're often referring to this idea of, have you personally received what Jesus has done for you? Did you hear what Jesus said again? He said, I am the gate. The one who enters in through the gate will be saved. This is actually not new in the Protestant movement because Martin Luther made a distinction between what he called historical faith, which was meaning believing the historical facts about Jesus, and saving faith. Personally trusting it for yourself. Sometimes people say, is it really possible to believe that Jesus died and was even raised and not have saving faith, just to believe those facts? We have a modern day example of that. One of the actual early leaders of the state of Israel, he had cabinet posts in the state of Israel, was a guy who was also a great scholar. His name was Pincus Lapid. And he believed the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. He even wrote a book about it. A guy, Pincus Lapid. But he never became a Christian and never accepted Jesus as his Savior. He was a classic example of having historical faith. He believed in the history. He trusted in the facts of Jesus' life, but he didn't personally trust Jesus. These distinctions that go way back to the very beginnings of the Reformation with Martin Luther. But the Pietist movement in Germany begins about 200 years later when they believe that the church in Germany has become dead, not alive. You see, this description of Luke's is of a church alive. Something that Luke does here is that he brackets this account with two descriptions of the growth of the church. Verse 41, which is the reading just before what we read, says, 3,000 were added to their number, right? And then we just ended with, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. See, you know what Luke is trying to say is this is a dynamic, living, vibrant group. And he's bracketing it in a way to say, this is the secret to the life and growth of this organization called the church. It's a living thing. And the pietists were people who who were resisting what they saw the deadening effects of a kind of overly scholastic intellectual approach to religion that had developed after the Reformation. And so roughly in the 1700s, about 200 years after the beginning of the Reformation, they began to say, no, we need to get back to the original pattern. One of the great Pietist commentators, he's considered one of the fathers of modern Bible commentaries, who lived from 1687 to 1752, right in that time when this movement was getting born. Speaking of this pattern that Luke is setting down here in Acts chapter 2, he says, "Thou hast, O church, thy form," meaning pattern. "It is thine to preserve it and guard thy trust." He's saying there is a way for us to be the church. And we need to be that way if we're going to experience the life, the vitality, the power that we see in the book of Acts. The founder of Pietism was a guy named Philipp Jakob Spener, another German Lutheran Pietist. And he proposed six reforms of the church. And when you listen to the reforms, they sound very much like what you hear going on here in the book of Acts. Number one, his proposal was, see, and again, this is after 200 years where the church has become not as vibrant and alive as it once had been in Germany. He says, we need to make sure that believers are more thoroughly acquainted with the Bible by means of private readings and study groups in addition to preaching. You see, he was the founder, really, of small groups. People nowadays have small groups where they study the Bible. We have our smaller Bible studies that we're doing. We have Sunday school, various things like that. Well, what do we hear right there in the book of Acts? He says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Number two, to increase in the involvement of laity in all functions of the church. What had developed in his day was a kind of clericalism where everything really revolved around the pastor. And he saw, no, it's to be the body of Christ where we're all involved using our gifts and our ministries. And here they're in each other's homes. They're in fellowship with each other. They're receiving the gifts of the full community. It says, number three, he put down to emphasize that believers put into practice their faith and knowledge of God, that they live it out. Well, we're going to see in just a moment that they were living it out as they were caring for one another's needs, making sure no one was going without. Number four, to approach religious discussions with humility and love and avoiding controversy wherever possible. What they were dealing with is that people seemed almost to have a joy about being right about their theology, and they didn't care that their spirit and that their heart and that their way of being were not expressing love. One of the things I want to look at in just a moment is that what was the power for Luke that caused this church to be alive? I think deep down it was a loving reality, a loving spirit. Number five, to ensure that pastors are both well-educated and pious, meaning that they need to be people who are praying, like they devoted themselves to prayer and having a relationship with God where they're growing in their faith. And then number six, to focus on preaching, make the focus of preaching developing faith in ordinary believers. That is, in his day, the sermon had become more of almost a school lecture, like an academic discussion. And he said, no, we need to get back to practical preaching that builds up the faith of members. And this was the group that eventually begins to use this term, being saved. What does it mean for Luke to speak about being saved? Well, on the one hand, he's talking about people who, in the verses just prior to our reading today, they were cut to the heart about their sin. They recognized that they were sinners, and they were told, be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins. What they had done is they had basically reached out for the lifesaver. And what was the lifesaver that Peter was offering them? Being baptized in the name of Jesus. He was emphasizing, be baptized for the purpose of connecting to Jesus. Jesus is the ultimate source of the salvation. He's the ultimate power of the salvation. He is the gate that we have to enter into. But he said, hold on to the objective act of being connected to him in baptism. And there doesn't have to be, as sometimes churches pit, sacraments versus personal trust as if it's one or the other. No, the two go together. On the one hand, there's the objective act of being baptized. But it's not the water in and of itself that saves. It's when it's being received for the purpose of being connected and receiving the ultimate work that was done in the person of Jesus. And when we personally receive our baptism for ourselves and we make it our own, we are saved. We have entered into the gate. And that's why we have this whole course of, and we call it instruction. It's not just an academic exercise where we're trying to get the kids to know information. We're trying to do the more difficult thing. It's actually a spiritual thing that the Holy Spirit has to do, of leading them to the conviction that they receive Jesus. They receive the gift their parents have been giving them all these years. And they make it their own, and they're holding on to Him, and they're trusting Him for themselves. And as they're doing that, that's what Luke means by being saved. But did you hear what Jesus said when He said, when they come into the gate, they're saved? Right after that, He says, and then I give them life. And life, I like the old King James the best, more abundantly. Or as our NIV said, life to the full. He equates being saved with also an experience of new life today. And this ongoing tense that Luke uses, those who are being saved, can also point to the fact that they are in time and space being transformed by a newness of life. As they're receiving Jesus, they're receiving it, and He's describing what that looks like. He says of these people whose hearts and lives are being changed, that it says of them, selling their possessions and goods, they gave to everyone who had need. Now, sometimes in the past, people have looked at that as like a putting down of a law that we need to almost embrace a kind of communism where we just sell everything and hold everything in common. And that's not what Luke means at all, because later on he'll talk about people in this same book owning their own property and giving from themselves. And you read the letters written to churches, and they're encouraged to give from what is theirs. There was never a loss of private property. And it would be very wrong to turn this into some kind of program, because that's not what Luke means at all. He's pointing instead to something they're doing spontaneously. It's not the result of some kind of external law or program. He's trying to say this is what was happening to their hearts. Their values had changed. A very old church father from the 600s, Bede the Venerable, who was an early British church father who wrote the Ecclesiastical History of the English People and was a Benedictine. He was put under the care of the Benedictine monks when he was just a child. Speaking of this passage, he says, if the love of God pervades our hearts, without a doubt it will soon engender affection for our neighbor as well. Hence, because of the double ardor of one and the same love, we read that the Holy Spirit was given twice to the apostles, and the possession of everything without any having any of his own is a great token of brotherly love. That is, they looked at what was theirs as not theirs to be held on to and grasped. They still had what was theirs, but they now, out of this overflow of love, out of the life they were receiving from being saved, they were giving. You might say the great fruit and sign of being saved, of being in a relationship with Jesus, is you begin to love other people. Because as we said in our confession of faith, that we experience the love of God and what Jesus did for us. God demonstrates His love for us in this. And as we're receiving that, and as we're living that, the Holy Spirit sheds the love of God abroad in our hearts. And the spontaneous, natural overflow of that, as Bede the Venerable says, writing way back in the 600s and the 700s, overflows in the giving to other people. And that was the secret and the power and the dynamism of this early church. It was the power of a changed life. It was the power of the fruit of the reality of God's presence, what we call the fruit of the Spirit. And one translation of the fruit of the Spirit, that fruit in Galatians chapter 5, says it's love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, meekness, goodness, generosity. One of the translations has. And I looked that up, and one of those words has that nuance. Not every translation brings that nuance out, but one of the words has that nuance of one of the fruits of the fruit of the Spirit, the signs that you are in contact with God, is a kind and generous heart. In fact, I've titled this sermon, The Community of the Transformed Heart, because that's also what Luke is pointing to as the secret to the power and the transformation that took place here. Because he says here, it says, speaking of them, and I got to find it again. Yeah, it's in verse 46. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Now, he's picking these words purposely. They're not just for rhetorical flourish, beautification of the story. He's getting across, and that word sincere, when it says sincere hearts, it's the word in Greek that has the negative on the front of it, and then rocks, meaning without stones. It was referred to a field that had been prepared to be planted and for there to be great fruit to come out of the field, right? They were going to sow the seed in that field, and it was going to bring forth a harvest of whatever seeds they planted. And to be a sincere field, so to speak, was to have all the stones removed. And do you see what Luke is, in a way, implying here with this word is that these people had all that was in their lives that impeded them from loving, that impeded them from bearing the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the reality of God in their life, taken out so that they could grow the good and wonderful fruit of the reality of Christ. And he also calls it a glad heart. One of the commentaries I looked at did a listing of all the references to joy in the book of Acts. If you want to look, just go to my Bible study notes that are on the website from this last Sunday, and there's that, or last Thursday, and that list is there. And for Luke, joy is the distinguishing mark of the church, a place that is filled with gladness, with a sense of joy that is coming from this reality of God in your life, of the Holy Spirit. And that is a winsome community. That is a beautiful thing. One of the commentaries said, what Luke is painting here is the beauty of the church, that it is naturally attractional, that when a church is living in this way and it's not a dead place filled with people who are not personally being saved, personally receiving the healing and transforming power of having Christ in your life, when it becomes that place where that's happening, it can't help but grow. And so Luke brackets it with these people joining in the beginning and at the end saying, this is the secret to being relevant in your time. You know, there's even a Christian magazine today called Relevant. And it's a part of this kind of subculture in Christianity that sometimes seems to equate relevance with the pastor wearing acid-washed jeans, having the latest hipster haircut, and wearing the most fashionable glasses or whatever, and of the church using the most up-to-date techniques in doing their worship. And they are doing that because they want to be relevant, they want to be dynamic, they want to be potent, they want to make an impact. Now, I don't think there's anything wrong with using modern means of communication. We're trying to do that the best we can here, with what we've been given here at Salem, by using Facebook, by doing video, by having a mic that I wear. These are all modern things. There's nothing wrong with having TV screens up to project images, to use words like that. But if we look to those things as the way in which we're relevant, the way in which we're potent, the way in which we're dynamic, we're missing it. Well, then what is the ultimate source? We've been pointing to it all along. But we want to get back to where he was saying this ultimate source is that makes this church so beautiful that Luke is painting, so powerful, so dynamic. Well, it was in the opening verse that we read. They devoted themselves. When you devote yourself to something, you give yourself over to it. You pursue it. People are devoted to certain sports. They'll not only just practice when the team practices, they'll go get a batting coach. They'll go get a pitching coach. If a person is devoted to a particular knowledge that they want to gain, the best students don't just study in class with the teacher. They're reading on their own time because they have a single-minded purpose. Well, he says that this early church was single-minded in purpose about four things. And Luke is deliberately saying, remember what that great pietist commentator says. He says the church has a pattern. It has a form. It's ours to preserve it, our guard to trust. And this is the pattern that Luke is laying down. This is what you should be single-mindedly focused on, he said. Number one, the apostles' teaching. Now, of course, that means going to the Bible, but not just the Bible in and of itself. The Bible as the means of encountering Christ. Now, I trust the whole Bible. I hold to the Bible being infallible for both faith and practice, both for what we believe and how we behave. But the Bible, rightly interpreted, is interpreted through the apostles' teaching, was Jesus Christ as the fulfillment of the Bible. So when the apostles say the Old Testament laws are a shadow, Christ is the substance, I don't follow those Old Testament laws when they've been fulfilled in Christ. When they're not fulfilled in Christ, like the moral law, we continue to follow them. What is this saying? It's saying they continued to be Christ-centered. Christ was being the very... Remember we said, he begins the book by saying, in my former book, I wrote about all Jesus began to do and teach. What we're saying is we're continuing to want to hear from Jesus as he interprets the scriptures for us. Number two, to the fellowship. I like what one of the commentaries said about this phrase, the fellowship. This is an older commentator, Kretzmann. He said, a wonderful blessed intimacy by which they were attached more closely to one another than brother and sisters to the flesh. Well, why this blessed intimacy, this communion? Well, interestingly, this is the only place where Luke uses the word koinonia. But that word koinonia is the same word that Paul will use for the Lord's Supper. He calls it a communion in the body of Christ, a communion in the blood of Christ. And I believe that what this is pointing to is that they were devoted to communing in the body of Christ. Again, just as they were going to the scriptures to know Christ, they were going to the church to know Christ in the diversity of the gifts poured out into the individual person's lives. And they saw in the people that I am seeing by faith sitting in this pew right now as expressions of Christ. And they wanted to be wherever Christ was. And since Christ is to be found in my brother and sister believer, who is filled with his presence and reality, then I want to be with my brother and sister believer so I can be near to Christ. You notice that no person of the disciples had a relationship with Jesus apart from being in the group. You know, he didn't say, now you can be my follower and just be by yourself. No, they were all together as they followed Jesus. And again, he was setting down a pattern that as you're in the group and as you're in that fellowship, you'll be receiving my presence. How else were they receiving Christ? With the breaking of bread. This was a taking of the first act in the meal, that Jewish meal that Jesus redefined for himself, was first to break bread. And one of the things that they did in that day was to take the first thing and make it the name of something. And so the name for the Lord's Supper at that time was the breaking of bread. Why? We just said that one of the ways we receive Jesus is to receive our baptism. That's the objective means by which we're saying, I want union with Jesus. Well, we have not just one sacrament, we have two. And every time we receive the bread and we receive the wine, we are objectively saying and receiving Christ. And then finally, to prayer. And of course, Christian prayer is this intimacy with God in Jesus' name, where we're united to Jesus and we're turning to God as our Father. And it's in that setting, Luke says, of this community that is living off of the power of Christ. And did you notice what Luke, how he said it? And he said, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. He's saying it wasn't them who was adding people to the church in their strength and in their technique and in their having the latest technology or they're using the latest methods. No, it was the Lord in the power of his presence in their lives who was saving people, healing people, transforming them, continuing to do his work on the earth, being the good shepherd of the sheep, seeking and saving the lost, him doing it through the body, through the power of the people of a transformed heart. Would you bow with me as we pray? Father, we thank you for this gift. of the body of Christ and for the blessing of the presence of Jesus in this body. Thank you that you will continue to work in and through this body to cause people to become and to be being all on in a process of being saved. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, right now we have that opportunity to reach out and to receive once more in a personal, saving way, Christ. Again, we don't have to separate personal, saving faith and trust with objective means of a sacrament of grace. The two go together. As we take the bread that we have set aside at home for this act, and we're setting it aside at home. You're at home, but you are setting aside with me for the purpose of connecting to Jesus, and you're receiving it for that, then you are receiving Christ. And it's He who is saving you, not the bread, but He's chosen to use your receiving that bread as the means of accepting and connecting with Him. And then if you have wine or grape juice, but if you don't, that's fine. Just receiving one of the two would be enough to have connected with Him. But if you have grape juice or wine, again, as we receive that, for the purpose of connecting with Jesus, we are connecting with Him. But of course, we come as those who, like those first Christians, are cut to the heart. We know we're sinners, and we are displeased with ourselves, and we're wanting to be saved from the way we're living. And so as a sign of that, we pray this prayer of confession. I invite you to make this prayer your own. Gracious God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you have promised to receive us when we come to you. We confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have disobeyed your law. We have not loved you or our neighbors as we should. Forgive us, O God. Grant that we may live and serve you in newness of life. For we ask it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you have prayed that prayer and you are wanting to be saved from your sins, and you are wanting the power of the new life, then I can tell you that in Jesus Christ you are forgiven, and He will come into your life and be the power of a new life. We remember on the night He was betrayed, after He had given thanks, He took the bread and He broke it. And He said, "This is my body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after the supper, He took the cup, and He said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for the remission of your sins. As oft as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." Would you bow with me as we pray? O God, as we approach this supper, this sacrament of the body and blood of Christ, we approach it as those who are wanting Christ in our lives. We are wanting to enter once more into the gate and to be saved. And so we pray that you would give us your Holy Spirit, that this would be a true communion in Christ, in His saving reality, in His shed blood, and in His broken body. For we pray it in His name. Amen. I invite you now, those of you who have your bread ready at home, to take your bread and to hold it. Jesus said, "This is my body, broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of Him." Now again, if that's all you have connected with Christ. He is in your life. You have reached out in faith for Him. And remember what He says, "The one who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out." But if you have grape juice or wine, I invite you to take that now. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for the remission of your sins. Drink this in remembrance of Him." At this time, I'm going to pray a prayer of thanksgiving over this meal. Thank you, Lord. Again, thank you that you did consider the straying sheep. You demonstrated your own love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, the Good Shepherd laid down his life for the sheep, and he is the gateway to eternal life, and that we can enter into that gate and know that we are saved. We are in the right with you. We pray now that as we go out into the world, we would show that our lives are being saved by the newness of life, the abundance of life being poured into our hearts through the love of God expressed in works of love. For we pray it in Jesus' holy name. Amen. At this time, we'll join the congregation once more from a few years back as together we sing with them, "We Are God's People." He lives. Jesus is alive. And because he's alive, we can know life and that more abundantly. And because we're coming to know life and that more abundantly, he makes us a living community, relevant, potent, dynamic, making a difference in the world because of that new life. I want to give you once more this Eastertide benediction. I just think it's so good for the season of celebrating the life that has appeared in Jesus. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.